So I wanted to start just with a question because there's two very different talks that could happen, and I want to be talking with you and not just at you. So we could talk about how to write successfully and connect, or we could talk about how to make a lot of money writing and being a benefit to the world. So the first one is sort of, you know, tips about writing. Second one is actually how to be a writer or an author who can pay her or his bills and, you know, be successful and connect. So I'm happy to do either one, or we could do a little of both. Both is kind of the easy way out, though.
About your wife, that's what I'm so curious about. Money for nothing and the chicks for free.
Right. Well, my life was very...
Just the money.
Right. My life was incredibly interesting until I started Elephant. And from that day on, it's basically been me at a cafe on my laptop 12 years ago. But up until then, I was born in Boulder to in the Buddhist community. And it feels almost like a fictional world you'd read about in Tolkien or something. It was an incredibly well-formed world that is incredibly unique and has all, you know, it's kind of hard to describe, but I grew up going through basically intensive Buddhist training that was very fun and very hard my whole life. And it was by choice. I didn't do it. You kind of can't be Buddhist properly, at least, because your parents want you to be. It's way too boring for that. To actually meditate. Sit down and meditate for an hour. No one can really make you do that. You could fake it, I guess, but nothing would happen. And if you do it right, nothing happens as well. So it's kind of win-win. and then I went to... I always wanted to be a writer when I was 8. My nickname, which was not very imaginative in Little League, was Homer Waylon. It's probably the peak of my career. But I wanted to be a baseball writer, you know, because I loved the Yankees and all that. Half my family is from New York. Sorry if there's any Bo Sox fans, but I did live in Boston for 7 or 8 years as well. It was a painful period of my life, baseball-wise. So I wanted to be a baseball writer, and then as I grew up, I just wanted to be a writer. I idolized Edward R. Murrow and others. Some of you may know him. Does anyone here know Murrow? I'm sure some of the edumacated ones among us know him, but he's sort of the, you know, the Jesus H. Christ of journalism. He's the one we all look to, the one who was successful and had integrity and was sort of the father of modern journalism ethics. And one of the very few people who solved that riddle that we're still trying to solve, which is how to talk to the masses about important stuff in a way that they give a care about. Instead of, you know, even now we can't get anyone to read about climate change, but if you put up a photo of Kim Kardashian, everyone goes crazy and runs around in circles. So that's about it. I went to journalism school at Boston University, one of the top journalism schools, and I was one of the nerdiest among all the students there. I loved it and got torn to pieces by my professors and loved that and did very well. And then went to Shambhala Publications, which was a good coming together of my Buddhist kind of background. Shambhala is a publisher. People may know it. There may be some Shambhala books in here. A lot of psychology and a lot of Eastern stuff. There's a Ken Wilber book from Shambhala. Anyway, so I did that for a while. I actually worked with Ken Wilber and some other authors. That was kind of my job, which was an awesome job that paid $8.50 an hour. So after a year or two, I realized that, you know, I wanted to make money and not just have a good life. My mom had a very good, meaningful life and never made more than $12,000 a year, which is a pretty amazing feat considering she raised me and all that. So I wanted to, you know, make money and change the world and have some fun doing so. So I think that's sort of what today's talk could be about in terms of writing. Does that sound interesting? And if you want to ask more questions specifically about writing, I love to talk about that. But that's more of a timeless craft that probably many of you know a lot about. And the social media or the modern component of it may be a little more unique and interesting to people. I find it more boring. I find it more fun to talk about writing than to talk about social media. Social media is kind of a monster in a way. And like all monsters, it can be fun to ride if you can learn how to fly a dragon. So that's my life, I guess. Leaving out the stuff about the women, whatever you mentioned. And then 12 years ago, or 13 years ago now, I went to a semester at Naropa, sort of on a lark. I was going to leave Boulder. I went to the Kerouac Riding School. It's one of their two kind of prominent schools, along with psychology, I think. And I went there for grad school. I had more debt in one semester at Naropa than I'd had in 4 years at Boston University. So I was about to cut out and go to a good grad school for writing and write a couple novels, which is kind of a fun thing to do, be in grad school and write some novels. But then I actually started getting back into freelance journalism. I lived at Chautauqua at the time in a cottage. I walked out of my cottage one day and ran into my neighbor who's a freelance journalist, and I asked her how to be a writer since I hadn't written for a couple years because I'd been worked at Shambhala Mountain Center doing PR, and that's where I learned my sort of business, got my business chops. I had an amazing mentor. We raised $12.5 million in 3 years and built a bunch of buildings. And I learned my strengths as a business person and my weaknesses, which continue to this day. But my greatest strength, which my mom, again, didn't have, and, you know, I love her, so this is not a criticism. She would not call herself a business person. In any case, my greatest strength as a business person early on was to realize that if I did have weaknesses, that's okay, and you can hire people to help you. You don't have to be able to do everything. And if you're not good at some things, like I suck at, say, accounting, that doesn't mean you can't. Doesn't mean you shouldn't get into business. So really, business is a team sport. So I started Elephant. It was a print magazine, as some of you remember. Does anyone ever see Elephant magazine when it was a print magazine? You did? Mm-hmm. Wow. It's like half of you. Yeah. We had some early teen readers. What's that?
Your mother read it while she was in
utero. Yeah, right. So Elephant, I loved everyone, you know, I can't say everyone, but many people loved Elephant the magazine because it was a magazine. You could curl up in the couch and read it. I kind of hated it. As a mission-based writer, I wanted to change the world and have fun doing so. Maybe only 15% of your effort, which is immense, creating a magazine, actually translates to connecting with readers. Most of it's spent getting ads to pay for the paper and distribution and design. And some of that stuff can be fun or fine. You know, it's like doing the dishes. It's actually not that bad once you do it. But it's also not the mission. So I had a lot of good friends who were starting blogs, and Tree Hugger. People know Tree Hugger? Anyone know Tree Hugger here? Just get a little audience participation. You can stretch once in a while. Treehugger.com. Most people don't know it here, interestingly, because they sold out to Planet Green. But they were huge. They were the biggest, maybe they still are, in environmentalism. They were very hip. They made fun of themselves, like the name. And so my friend Graham Hill there sold for $10 million, which was deeply undervalued for how big it was. And a lot of much smaller blogs sold for a lot more. And suddenly I saw that, wow, you could skip printing, which wasn't that eco. We were on state-of-the-art paper, better than anyone, honestly, because we paid so much for it. And we distributed mindfully. Like, we didn't distribute through the huge distributors who throw away 7 out of 10 magazines. Or recycle them, and recycling is pretty bad environmentally when it comes to magazine paper. But without getting too detailed, is anyone interested in the magazine business and environment? Probably not. So I saw that you could do this magical thing. Like, people read Harry Potter around 2000, right? It was still magic when she wrote that, the idea that you could have a moving image in the newspaper that they're reading on the train, right? Well, that's exactly what a blog is. You can write a thing and then put a video that moves in it. To me, it was like, you know, maybe it's ordinary, but it was also kind of ordinary magic to me. So we, well, not we. I decided at some point to go online, and we had to lay off our whole staff, except for an editor or two. Most of our staff were climbers and, you know, boulder types, so they didn't really care. They just went off and climbed. Or did yoga more or something. But we gave up our office. I gave up 6-7 years of work, and we'd had a couple offers to sell. So it was valued at a fair amount, and I just gave all that up because I felt like I didn't want to sell out. Media, when it sells out, usually sells out its voice along with everything else. Not always, but, you know, again, I was mission-driven, and I felt confident I could rebuild it online. So we went online, and that took 3 years, and I lost all my staff, and my house went into foreclosure. It was an intense time. But the whole time, our readership was rising. And I did it through everything possible. I jumped into Twitter, which was hot at the time, not so hot anymore. And they just laid off 300 people today, I think, or yesterday, which actually might be smart. But we won national awards for Twitter twice for environmental coverage. That put us on the map with advertisers and all that. But we still weren't making any money, even though we were growing, growing, growing. And people said, well, once you're at 100,000 readers a month, which at the time was considered a milestone, everything's grown since. You'll get advertising. We didn't get it. We got to 100, 200, 500,000. We didn't get the advertising. So eventually I had this kind of journalism moment where I said, I know people will pay to read something if they love it and they want it and they need it. And if it's easy, and they'll do it online. And no one was charging online at the time except for Wall Street Journal and a couple financial publications. New York Times wasn't charging at the time, and they're doing it very successfully now. Did people see the New York Times announcement about their subscriptions? It's last week. They have more subscriptions than any time in history. Their staff is just as big as 15 years ago. Those are amazing accomplishments for journalism in the modern day. And they're doing tons of investigative original work. So we put together this, what I called a pay gate. So people know the paywall. Paywall is when you go to a website and it says you have to pay. Everyone leaves and then the website collapses and everyone goes out of business. A pay gate, as I termed it, was something where they would come to the site, they'd be let in, they could read 3 articles in the day for free, 21 a week, and then we'd kind of show them the door. We'd say, okay, please come back tomorrow. Thanks for reading so much. Please come back tomorrow, or you can subscribe for $1 a month. So we made it as low as possible. We made it as easy as possible. And suddenly we went from broke, no matter how much we were growing, to stable overnight. Overnight, it was probably 8 times the financial value of our advertising. Now it's more like probably 50-40 or something like that. We still make more money from subscribers paying $1 a month than we do from ads, partially because we kind of hate ads, so we don't really focus on ads too much. Ads are kind of the business of selling crap to people who don't need crap. And the good stuff usually doesn't get advertised, right? The stuff people actually need, typically they already have it, and maybe it lasts, maybe it's made well. So, you know, you're not selling, like, the stuff you see for sale are, like, fad diets and stuff like that. And we don't want to make our money off of that. So, I don't know. That's probably that story. And now, you know, once we got to 20, right now we're at 14. Facebook just kind of cut our legs out from under us last month. But we'll get back up. But we were at 25 million readers a month. Once you have that kind of traction, your $1 a month subscription suddenly becomes like the long tail for those who know about that, and it's incredibly stable. We can have a bad month like we just had, and our money doesn't go down at all because people are just subscribed. Our new money will go down significantly, so if that continued, we'd have to lay off people, and that's part of the challenge of social media. Facebook definitely doesn't care about Elephant or about you. What they do care about, and they're not evil by any means, what they do care about is views and interaction. So if they can get, so they're starting, what's that?
And selling your data.
And selling your data. So like they're, well, they it's not very funny. You know, they read your messages, they do everything. And it's not like someone's sitting there reading it, but they're searching everything you do on Facebook and trying to monetize that. And that's not evil. That's just capitalism, which might be a little evil. But it's certainly not like a nonprofit. Like Facebook's mission is not to turn the whole world into, you know, Mother Teresa and Gandhi slow dancing. So then I kind of full circle. 13 years ago, I wrote most of a couple novels while in one semester at Naropa, but I never finished, and I kind of left aside my own writing. But I was blogging every day, which is kind of the equivalent of shagging flies or, you know, hitting grounders in more baseball stuff. But like really good practice. I've written more in the last 12 years than probably most book writers, just because you're blogging all the time. But it's not really, even if it's good or quality, it's not really in depth, of course. Some blogs are, but most aren't. So I came back, I wrote, so this is the part about sort of how to monetize a book. If any of you want to write a book and make good money doing so, it's not hard right now. It's actually probably easier than it's ever been in history, I would say. There's this radical new invention that didn't even exist 13 years ago, which if it had, I definitely would not have started Elephant, because I could have just, you know, written books and lived on a ranch somewhere and, you know, Instagram photos of myself or whatever, instead of working so hard. So there's this thing called crowdfunding, whether it's GoFundMe or Kickstarter or Indiegogo, and it's unbelievable. But to be funded by a crowd, you have to have a crowd. So for two things, you need to have a crowd. One, you have to be a decent writer or have a message that people want to connect with. And two, you need a way to connect with the crowd, which would be social media for the most part, unless you're going to like bike around Boulder with your flyer. Go to http://kickstarter.com/Waylon's book. That would be tough. So 75% of all social media at this point, at least for Elephant, is Facebook. So it's a pretty short conversation. If you don't have a huge Facebook page or a huge blog off of Facebook, which that's not really social media, so I had an advantage there with Elephant Journal. You're not gonna be able to crowdfund very easily. So I'm not used to talking over lunches, so distracting. So any questions about, maybe I'll start with a question on crowdfunding or any of this stuff. That. Yeah, please, whatever you like.
A couple of things, you worked on a novel or two, whatever. Uh-huh. One of my favorite novels of all time was a serial originally too. I think it was Esquire, it was Tom Wolfe's Bonfire of the Vanities. Mm-hmm. Have you ever thought of writing a novel in segments and then it comes together as a book?
Yeah, so I mean that goes back to Dickens and I'm sure far before that, right?
Right.
Serializing. So that's actually how I wrote my book. So there's this fancy term called A-B testing. A-B testing, do people know what that means?
Yes.
Does anyone bravely not know what it means? So who wants to define it very simply? Who wants to define it? All right.
Change one parameter on a page and then see how users react. So for example, change the color of the buy button on Amazon, and does that increase sales or not?
So it's kind of like you could put out a red cover and you could put out an orange cover. You know, you could have the blog, if it's your A-B testing. So Upworthy, people remember Upworthy? I say it almost in the past tense because they kind of got, you know, their balloon was popped by Facebook very directly. Upworthy figured out how to A-B test their blogs through their newsletters and then put the winner up on Facebook. And Upworthy went like this and was bigger than New York Times. And then Facebook literally made a set of rule changes that were kind of casually called like the Upworthy killer rules or whatever, basically to deflate Upworthy. And because there were like 800 sites who that rose up imitating, you know, those Upworthy headlines?
The clickbait.
Huh?
The clickbait.
They're clickbait, but they're a lot of people do clickbait before and after, but Upworthy sort of was like Facebook bait. And there's nothing evil about it. Clickbait, people say clickbait, it sounds like the ugliest word, I feel like. Clickbait is basically trying to get readers to read what you've written. Nothing about that is evil. That's like calling a bookstore, like, you know, the Mordor, the source of hell. But clickbait can be kind of evil, and the reason we think of it as evil is because they're just trying to make money and they're crappy blogs and they're kind of tricking you. So once you come in, the content really isn't there. People once in a while say to Elephant, like, that blog title is clickbait. And I'm always like, you know, it's an article about, like, three ways to use turmeric, you know, whatever. And I'm like, what do you mean by clickbait? Because there's nothing, yes, we're trying to get you to read Elephant. We're a publication. That's literally our purpose. Are we tricking you? Are we saying nude photos of Kim Kardashian? You click in and it's like three ways to use turmeric to go to bed. No, we're not tricking you. The title may be like, this amazing herb, or whatever, is it an herb? This amazing herb will put you to sleep, insomniacs. And that could be kind of clickbaity. People could call that clickbaity. I'm like, well, you know, okay. Whatever. It's like calling a baby like an irresponsible human being. Yeah, it's just a baby, you know? It is what it is. Or yelling at your dog because he hasn't shaved lately. I mean, you're just like being weird. But clickbait, as I would define it, is you're actually tricking someone. So when you click it, so the headline is sort of vague and meaningless, which we do. But then when you click in, what you expected to find isn't there. And, you know, Upworthy also had the subtitles that said, at 30 seconds in, your jaw will drop. And you're like, okay, you know, gets a little clickbaity. So, where was I? No idea.
Serializing a novel.
So, The Mindful Life. Someone's got mindfulness, and it's not me. So, yeah, so I wrote this. So I've been working night and day, literally 7 days a week, 6 days a week, never less than six, for 12 or 13 years. So there's a level of burnout, even doing what you love, that kind of accumulates. And one day I sat down and I wrote, I think I'd just been on this first date with this lady, and I sat down and I wrote this thing that was sort of about the date, but not really. It wasn't really fiction at all, because it was sort of just poetic, but it definitely wasn't poetry. It was prose. And it was kind of about me, but it also wasn't, it was more just about this feeling. It wasn't really autobiographical. It literally kind of defied genre, which isn't really cool. It just means it didn't fit in. With, you know, people always say with my book, like, oh, is it a novel or is it your life or what is it? I have no idea what it is. Hopefully it's fun to read, but I have no idea what it is. So I wrote this thing that was just really expressing this sort of burnout and this longing for kind of just taking a break. Taking a break with someone in nature, far away, for a couple days. That's all I ask. And it was titled "Things I Would Like to Do with You in the Woods." That was the first. And what's that?
That's clickbait.
Yeah. I have a comeback if you can be quiet. It's more like chickbait, but yeah. I've never said that before. That's not funny. Take that out. So I wrote it, and, you know, I write a lot of stuff, and I put it up, and some does well, and some doesn't, and some does really well, and some doesn't, and I wrote that in it, and the reaction, not only did it do well, but the reaction, people know about trolls and stuff like that on the internet, right? It's impossible to get 100% good feedback on the internet. And you could post a photo of, like, a teddy bear hugging a kitten, hugging a puppy, and someone will yell at you about it not being a rescue puppy or something. And they should. But shame on you. But, you know, I wrote this thing, and it, not only was it popular, even though it wasn't something that would be on Reddit, you know, if people know Reddit. It wasn't something that really seemed like it would be that popular. And not only that, the feedback was 100% positive. Not only positive, it was, like, adulatory. It was, like, everyone on Earth who felt burnt out and wanted to be in love or just have that feeling of love, but a sort of innocent love, like not a very sexual love, that was later, but a very like almost childlike love out in nature. Everyone sort of just connected with it. And it wasn't, and that I think that was the power, that it wasn't about me. It was really just about that feeling. So I was like, whoa, that was interesting. That was amazing. I mean, I'd never in, again, 11 years at the time of blogging had anything even close to that. So that's how it organically, to use a bolder term, started. I started serializing it. So I wrote another one on our second date. We went to Shakespeare, Colorado Shakespeare Fest. And I started mixing in like other stories and other, you know, dates. And there was a lot of loneliness and there was a lot of, I just love writing and I hadn't written for a long time. It wasn't blog writing, which can be kind of charming and fun and whatever, but it was like writing. And it was like writing, you know, and it's a joke, but I just watched this amazing like spoken word poem on YouTube where this guy was criticizing how kids these days talk. How you say, you know, at the end of every sentence and like, and you never have confidence in what you're saying anymore. So I wrote another one. It was, again, it was like striking gold twice, which isn't the point of writing it, but it's an interesting experience. And then I wrote a third one, and you know, some were easy and some were difficult. And one thing I did a really good job in was if I didn't have the inspiration, I wouldn't write for months. Like sometimes there'd be months between a thing, and I thought, well, maybe it's over, you know? Because I couldn't really fake it. It was pretty genuine stuff. And sometimes it was maybe a little sexy, or sometimes it was a little frustrated, or sometimes it was, you know, it was all over the map. It wasn't just one note. And they all had different titles that were sort of thingsy, things I would love, something. And eventually I had 28 chapters, and we decided to make it a book. And I'd been talking with publishers for years because of Elephant. And all the publishers I'd talked to, some of which were pretty decent. You know, publishing's going through a really tough time. People may know that. So a pretty cool-sounding publisher can sign you up and then do nothing for your book other than maybe edit it and print it. And you don't have control over the cover. It's not going to be on eco paper, certainly. And they won't pay for a real book tour unless they decide you're one of the, like, five books that year that they're going to push. Because so many independent bookstores have closed, even like Borders closing, there's a real attitude with books that it has to be a blockbuster to get it to work at all, and that all the little niche books, they're fine, we'll still publish them, but we're gonna print 10,000, even if we're Little Brown or something, a big Random House, whoever, and we're not gonna push them. It's all up to you. And then, you know, and that's a fair attitude. If I were a publisher, I'd probably have that attitude as well. And then you'll see which authors kind of market their own books successfully and which ones hit, and then maybe you put more money into their second book. I didn't really like any of that. I wanted a big book tour because I know that's how you sell stuff. I mean, I'm in the blogging business. I know a blog isn't just, you don't just write a blog, put it out there and wait for success to happen. You have to reach people, Facebook, etc. So we have more than 2 million Facebook fans, and we didn't get that by just sitting around waiting for success to happen. We've had to work at it. Same with Instagram or anything. Twitter. It's a real give and take. If you give a lot, then people will follow you and interact and share it. So I talked with some of the smaller or mid-sized publishers that I liked, and none of them print any eco-books, the ones I was talking with. And that right there was kind of a non-starter. So I said, well, we have, you know, at the time, I don't know what we had, but say 15 million readers a month. Why can't we just repackage our best content? Say our best content about love, our best content about right livelihood, work, our best content about environmentalism, our most popular, but also our best. We can very clearly see what's most popular on Elephant. So we repackage that, we make them ebooks. It's very simple, right? Ebooks, even very small ebooks, can make $10,000 a month for the writer. I have friends who did the Tiny House movie. Anyone see that? Tiny. And they did a ebook on that. They were making $10,000 a month off of that ebook because it had some instructions, and they had a website with no traffic. So people were going to the site to get that ebook. So we have tons of traffic, or readers as I prefer to call it. So I felt like, wow, ebooks is a win-win. So we started Elephant Books, and our idea was sort of to A-B test twice. So we would A-B test, like only put together the most popular stuff that was also quality that we liked, and then only the most popular ebooks that we sell, we would print. And we would print those on eco paper printed in the USA, probably in Michigan. There's very few US book publishers who have survived. And even those publishers don't really care about the environment. It's been very difficult to create Things I Would Like to Do With You, which is the book, in a sustainable way. So cloth covers, if they've been made in the last 10 or 20 years, I'm not exactly sure when it started being ubiquitous, they're coated in plastic, or they're made of plastic, even if they feel like cloth. So to find an actual cloth cover for our hardback things book took months. We want, you know, it's not necessarily an author's goal to see someone throw their book in the compost, but we would like the book to be compostable, ideally, not to be around in 50,000 years, you know, still giving cancer to people who try and read it. So now we're on state-of-the-art paper, state-of-the-art ink, which is not very good, soy-based, but it's still pretty bad stuff, but you can't really do better right now, and cloth cover, and we're going to press with our first Elephant Book. And the idea of Elephant Books is that with the ebooks particularly, we'll pay about 50%, which is an immense amount, to the author directly, because we have no intermediary. We're hosting the books. There's no print. There's no, you know, we don't have to pay 40% of the cost or whatever to the printing and the distribution. There's no bookstore. We are the bookstore and we are the publisher. So we'll actually make more money than conventional publishers, and we'll be able to give away far more money to authors. And we'll have A-B tested those, what we print. So hopefully we'll have a good success rate. And the final bonus is we'll have ads that won't be selling Windex or selling something we don't believe in, but they'll be selling books. They'll be selling good content that can help people's lives, hopefully. So that's my basic spiel, I feel like. Did you or did you not? So if you have any questions about how to be a successful writer, how to make money writing, or about how to write, or social media, any aspect in there, I'm all yours. All three question askers are right there, so I can just point. All four.
Sure. So when you're working with the internet as a medium, it seems to be more driven by the established consumer preferences than, say, a magazine or a book. Like the editor would be responsible in a magazine for choosing the content and kind of pushing the direction for the future, whereas the established consumer desires seem to be online. So the question that I'm asking is, as a new writer starting out, how do you drive change while addressing a large audience, and where do you see that differential? Like new content, a new way of seeing the world that might be slightly uncomfortable and might not attract the kind of audience that established content, even within the green or eco-friendly fields, would be. How do you approach that?
It's a great question. I mean, Trunk Brimshay said, he has this quote, he said, enlightenment, maybe you know this quote, enlightenment is the ego's ultimate disappointment. So you mentioned uncomfortable. Sharing stuff that people don't want to hear is a lot of what needs to be heard, but people aren't going to read it unless you can find a way like Upworthy. And in their defense, all they were trying to do was share stuff that was worthy of being shared for the most part. So that's the task of Jon Stewart, who did it more successfully than anyone in the last 10 or so years. That's the job of Elephant. That's the job of New York Times. That's the job of anyone in communication, is how do you communicate about needful, important things in a way that people want to read it? Because I guarantee you, so like the other day, Justin Bieber, for those of you who know Justin Bieber, this may be the wrong crowd, Hopefully, that's a compliment. You know, there was a bunch of paparazzi photos of him walking around naked with his ding-a-ling hanging out. And, you know, the whole internet went crazy. A lot of girls were a fan of that. A lot of girls who would yell at you for objectifying or whatever if you had, you know, a woman in a swimsuit were loving those photos. Let me tell you. It's crazy, the feedback we get on Elephant about stuff. We'll put, like, if we post a kind of sexy guy on Elephant, there's like 40 comments like, damn, you know, more please, whatever, from women. And then if we publish like a, you know, an attractive woman drinking turmeric tea, the comments are like, you chauvinist pigs, from the same people. Is almost comical, except it's what I have to deal with every day. But so coming back to the point, so how do you share, how do you ride the wave of Justin Bieber's ding-a-ling? That's what we're all here to talk about, isn't it? So there's this huge media moment, right? I mean, literally millions and millions and millions and millions of people are searching for that thing. So from a mindfulness point of view, what Trungpa Rinpoche did, I don't know if anyone knows him, but he was the founder of Shambhala and Naropa and stuff. He had all these different gateways for people. So there was working with drugs and addiction, ironically you could say, community. There was a sailing community. There was all different communities within the Buddhist world that he established because people had different entry points. There was horse riding. There was calligraphy, poetry. People have all kinds of different interests and they connect with Dharma or trying to be a good person through that gateway. So in the case of blogging or writing, I had the task of writing about this Justin Bieber thing. Literally. In a way that wasn't cheap and that was mindful. So what is that? That's the question I had asked myself, and that's sort of the only answer I can give you is that you have to ask yourself continually, how do I share what I care about in a way that people will read it? Because it's not enough. The social media answer to the koan, if you write about it and nobody's around to read it, doesn't make a sound. The answer is definitely not. Yeah. So you can write the best thing ever and it doesn't even make a little ripple. Unless you can find a way for it to connect. So my advice when I'm teaching our editors or writers is the title is like the storefront name, you know, Trident Cafe. That's the title of your blog or the title of your book. The image that the blog has attached is like the storefront. So both have to be inviting but not desperate. They have to be bright but not desperate. They need to be clear but maybe a little mysterious, so you kind of want to go check it out. Like Two Hands Papery is a great example of a blog to me. You know, it's a beautiful storefront. I want to go in. Same with Trident, same with Boulder Bookstores, same with, what are some other, Dushanbe Tea House. These are blogs that you want to go in. So if you have a beautiful, or like Harvard, the campus at Harvard, you know, it invites you in, it's mysterious, it's... So, you know, the best advice for a title is you have to actually be able to say it to your best friend. So the best titles, like Ashley is really good at this. One day we were hiking with our dogs. She's an editor at Elephant Journal. And one day she was like, well, that's why my family never gets sick, because we do these things or whatever. And I was like, whoa. I was like, whoa, yeah, you know, wow. You have to write a blog about that right now. So the blog, what was the actual title?
6 Reasons My Family Never Gets Sick.
Mm-hmm. I mean,
they got so many views.
You're writing about soup or whatever. You're writing about tea. You're writing about the most boring stuff on earth. But because of that amazing title, suddenly all those things become really interesting and magnetizing, and everyone has to read it because everyone's families are sick all the time. So irritating, and no one likes being sick. But if I say, you know, here's a soup that you could have in the winter and you'll feel good. Are you going to read it? No. Probably not. Actually, that was a pretty good title. Let's do it. But, you know, so it's really frustrating. I mean, honestly, we get attacked from both sides all the time, Elephant. People say, oh, all you do is write about sex and whatever. I'm like, sex is literally like 2% of what we write about. I have no problem with sex. Sex is part of a mindful life, a life well lived. You know, or dealing with sex, or dealing with your thoughts about not having sex, or whatever it is. Sexuality is part of the mindful life. But ironically, because of Facebook, sex may be 2% of what we write about, but it's 20% of what people read, and it's 200% of what people remember that we wrote about. And then all the stuff we write about, you know, fracking or climate change or whatever it is, people are like, meh, boring. You know, get me to Justin Bieber's penis. So it's frustrating. But
you pitch that, like sunbathing, and, you know, get 15 minutes worth of sunlight a day?
I made it like a Harry Potter title, actually. I was like, oh, the Justin Bieber thing? I said Justin Bieber in the case of the... I forgot. It was like the case of the errant ding-a-ling and the whatever. and then it talked about the objectification and the double standard and why everyone was loving searching for these photos. But a year ago, there was this thing where all the, I think it was only actresses in Hollywood, had their nude private photos exposed through iCloud or something, right?
Yeah.
And that was considered like a gross violation, which it was. And what's her name in Hunger Games?
Jennifer Lawrence.
Lawrence said it was akin to, I don't really remember. Does anyone remember? It was akin to sexual assault or rape. She was saying, this is a violation of my body and my privacy. And, you know, I think that's pretty fair. Was any of that conversation happening around Justin Bieber? Mm-hmm. Like, zero. So, that was the angle I chose. And the photo lead people in wasn't him naked or anything. We didn't have those photos in it. So, yeah.
So, I'm not standing on any moral high ground asking this question.
Okay, you're sitting.
I'm sitting in the muck.
Yeah.
And I'm trying to think how to phrase it. And sort of one lens of it is the question of creating content that makes money and hooks people. I was thinking, when you have a magazine, the moment somebody picks up and buys the magazine, they're committed to sort of flipping through all of it. And it's, you know, I guess online it's more of a piecemeal kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of funny that I'm here, I didn't realize what was going on, and Duncan was here, so I sat down, and I'm like, oh, the Elephant Journal guy. And I have a long-standing joke with my wife of, oh no, you're not going to forward me another fucking Elephant Journal article, are you? And I don't read it. I took myself off of Facebook a while ago.
Right.
And, you know, half of the articles are about how I'm not working out enough. Another you know, like how we're not practicing this particular neotantric sex practice, and we should really do that.
Wow. This should be a new section of our blog. Articles to send your husband in a passive-aggressive way.
I'm just sort of thinking about this, and I'm like...
We have a section, if I may interrupt briefly,
okay.
Just briefly. We have a whole section, it's on Facebook, so it won't do you much good, but you could search on Elephant, called Mindful Gentleman. And I've written some articles on Elephant. One of them was titled, If I Were a Man, which I am, I would not read Elephant. Because there's such a, you know, female-centric, kind of almost anti-man bias in a lot of the articles. Back to you.
I work for some people, and myself sit on a board of a company that makes a lot of money selling cosmetics. Mm-hmm. And the business of cosmetics, if you want to summarize it, is largely selling insecurity.
Mm-hmm. Right.
It's a harsh thing to realize.
That's and, fantastic.
I guess I was perceiving, I mean, I was like, stop your stupid articles. I love you, honey, but I'm not going to deal with this. But I did perceive a hook of in more than one article that is what sort of made me feel this way about the articles broadly, of like, oh, your sex life should be better this way. Oh, this is lacking in your life, which is the same thing that you get when you have a model put up on, you know, selling lipstick or something.
Yeah.
And again, I'm not sitting on any moral high ground.
No, I love.
And I'm just wondering if that's how deliberate is that? And I mean, I'm sure it works. And it's a tough question of balancing that with a mission statement.
I feel your pain, like Bill Clinton would say. I hate those blogs. Hate them. I don't dislike them. I hate them. And I've written probably a dozen articles that, to our readers' credit, are about makeup and being anti-makeup, and you'd be amazed. So we have one that I could share right now, and millions of people would read it. Anytime I share it, it's hugely popular. They're like before and after photos of people wearing makeup and not wearing makeup, and how beautiful and okay they look without makeup, mm-hmm. or with very, very little makeup.
That's your A-B test.
Yeah. Well, before and after right there, that's like ultimate, you know, you could call it clickbait. But when you use, so in Buddhism, not to get too Buddhist on everyone again, but there's this thing called Mahakala. It's sort of like a demon, is the notion of your neurosis, and that you can transmute or tame your neurosis, and it turns into a protector of truth. It turns into your wisdom. So if you can use before and after to underline before and after photos, instead of tell you that you should be on a diet or that you're bad and you need to read our blog or that you need to wear more makeup or something. I haven't seen too many blogs on elephants saying wear more makeup, but I get what you're saying about sex. Maybe you need to have better sex. If you can use the before and after, use those tools of the internet to underline people's fundamental okayness as they are. That's fantastic, because happiness, as we all know from Christianity and from Buddhism, from just about every tradition, is not external. Mm-hmm. I just did a video on that, which was very popular, thankfully. That was like talking about all the things that would make me happy in my sort of 12-year-old boy self, like a cool car, you know? If I have a BMW i8, I'm probably going to be happy, right? And then, you know, as we all know, you get the thing you want, and within even a couple days, you're back to being you. And you're not that happy. You know, somehow you got the coolest toy. We all had that experience at Christmas or whatever. You got the thing you wanted, and then you're, you know, you leave the BB gun in the closet a week later, or the hamster, or whatever it is. Yeah. And if you left the hamster in the closet, that sounds like a different kind of thing. But what I would say is that I do yell at our editors, as Ashley knows, right? Frequently. I see blogs that horrify me. There was a blog that you put up like 2 days ago that said, and it was actually a decent blog, so I don't think I yelled at you. But the title was, "Do This One Simple Thing to Be Super Happy," or something like that. Do you know what I'm talking about? I hate titles like that. Because you know what? I'm not going to read this blog and suddenly be happy because I did one simple thing. If you could read that blog and do that one simple thing and be happy, we wouldn't publish any more blogs. That would be the blog, and we would just share it every day, and we'd be huge, and we'd be rich. And there are simple things in life, of course, that do make you happy, like looking at the sky or going for a hike, or, you know, so it's not that truth can't be simple, but it's that kind of like snake oil salesman title that pisses me off. And I think those kind of blogs, you know, we have a problem. Like if someone puts up a good article about, you know, some sex title, like I had sex with my husband in this neo-tantric way and it was awesome, and the rest of you are missing out. Yeah, that could be a good article, maybe, right? An editor publishes it, and then it's super popular. It's about sex. And suddenly we have like 200 writers who send us similar articles because they're trying to get on the gravy train of the neo-tantric sex thing, you know? So it's hard for us to kind of, you know, it feels like it's whack-a-mole sometimes. And I employ 19 editors full-time to edit. Like, we are not Reddit. We are edit. We are editing. And it's still hard to kind of, you know, the only thing I can do, like a parent or anything, is to empower people to have their own judgment about what to put up. And I think the editors are great. But there is a learning process, and editors do drop out and burn out, and so it's a continual process. So first of all, I apologize.
I can't wait to tell my wife.
I don't apologize.
Self-apologize.
Yeah, no, I mean, I love it that people are sharing articles, but I don't like, if the fundamental message is you're not good enough and this will help you, that's tricky. That can be okay, or that can be, that can,
money.
Yeah, but believe you me, I mean, as people say, You're just trying to make money and stuff. I'm like, if I'm trying to make money doing Elephant Journal, you're calling me stupid. Because there are a lot easier ways to make good money. I've been doing this for 13 years. I have had no life on some level. The life I have that is not a life is amazing, and I'm privileged, and I get it. But I am not traveling. I'm not in a long-term relationship, because my long-term relationship, as one of my best friends said, is with my MacBook Pro. But my point is, like, I agree with how you feel. And honestly, you are the kind of audience we wish we had.
Why?
Well, we have a lot of articles. I could send you 100 articles within 2 minutes that I could just think of that you would love, that are amazing, that have a sense of humor, that make fun of this sort of spiritual materialism stuff, that are genuine. But the problem is, kind of coming back to your question, like, some of those aren't as popular, yeah. You know? And they don't necessarily get shared. But maybe I'll work on that, you know? Articles for wives to want to share to husbands that are good.
Are you accusing his wife of sending you the wrong article? Can he go home and say that?
I think the fundamental thing is she's saying she just wants to have more sex with you, which is not a bad thing. She can't get enough. You know that video, Flight of the Conchords? You know? It's business time.
Oh.
It's like, we have sex for a minute or two, and you say you want more, and I know you do. But it's over. I'm going to sleep. It's about, like, a long-term relationship and how, like, the sex is no longer that sexy, and they have sex for, like, a minute and a half with their socks on and, like, a ratty old T-shirt, and then they go to bed.
So you told us about your long-term relationships with your Mac. Yeah. How about your short-term relationships?
Oh, those are fun. I'm pretty attached to... That's a neurosis I need to tame and transmute. I'm pretty attached to, as an entrepreneur, being single is much easier as an entrepreneur than having a relationship, unless you're lucky enough to find someone who doesn't mind you obsessively, as she might put it, focusing on building something. I mean, we have so many challenges with Elephant. There's so many times where I'm like, oh, I'm gonna take the night off and do whatever, and I open up my laptop to, like, watch a Netflix and, like, have a dinner sitting down, you know? And I open it up and there's, like, an emergency and this thing, and, you know. So a month ago or 2 months ago, I actually kind of fell in love, and she lives in Berlin, and I was on my way to visit right about now. And then in the last month, we lost 11 million readers. So I delayed that visit a little bit. So, you know, being an entrepreneur and having a meaningful relationship can be difficult. Obviously, there's plenty of examples that I admire of partners supporting each other's work. But I do work pretty much all the time unless I'm exercising or...
So I don't want to ask you about Kickstarter, because that is a relationship as an entrepreneur.
Sure. Yeah, bring it back to what we were supposed to talk about.
No, it's a couple questions that were on my mind, too, and that is, as you launch and you put out your desire to raise, you know, $38,000.
Yeah.
Where were the points where you saw a jump in? It wasn't just a steady climb. Were there patterns, like in the first 5 days, the first 10 days, were there points when somebody talked about it, you got a boost? You got chosen, you know, cool side of the day equivalent on Kickstarter. Did you get to be an editor's pick?
Right.
But at what point, and what were the steps to that?
My experience with Kickstarter was somewhat disappointing. I think, what were we trying to raise, like 30? I don't remember what it was. Do you remember?
35?
35? I think I told you 35, but I honestly don't remember. But, you know, you calculate how much you need to print a book and distribute it in an eco manner. And whatever that goal was, that was our goal. And we got to 53. And that sounds pretty successful. But, you know, you're giving away 7% to Amazon and to PayPal. And you're doing a ton of work to make that happen. My experience was Kickstarter brought nothing. Like, being named editor's pick affected nothing.
But you talked about crowdfunding being a new way to make money.
The magic of crowdfunding was the mechanism that Kickstarter gave me. And that's why I would use it again. But I'm just saying there's a vaunted Kickstarter community that cares and will enroll, you know, support your thing. I saw none of that. I think some other projects, maybe if it's like Daniel's like iPhone widget or something, you know, maybe there's more of a tech, a practical things community.
So would your point about crowdfunding then be just to say it gave you the experience, but you wouldn't recommend it for making money?
No, I think crowdfunding is the most amazing development for entrepreneurs and integrity in business.
Not publishing.
No, I would include publishing. I'm just saying everything that happened in Kickstarter, other than the mechanism that they gave me, you know, of tracking the money and the timing, which was completely valuable and why I would do it again, they didn't bring anything else to the table. So in Kickstarter, they have millions of people are involved in the sort of Kickstarter universe or Indiegogo or GoFundMe. And the idea that they push on you is that if you put up a good thing, that community will come and support you. I saw like almost none of that. Everything, the success that we created was from my community, bringing that in. So it did feel a little bit like I was publicizing a different community, like different links instead of my own. Mm-hmm. If I had to do it again, I would probably try and figure out how to embed a kind of Kickstarter mechanism within Elephant and then promote my own link for a month instead of Kickstarter's. And I don't mind paying 3 or 4 or 5%, but once you're paying 7%, that's a fair amount. And it is so much work. I mean, I was getting hundreds of messages a day. It's really stressful. You're getting 100 plus messages a day from people who want to help you out. And if you don't respond, you're not a good person. But at the same time, responding to 100 messages a day, you just start going batty. Because most of the questions are sort of the same, or most of the things. So you're sort of saying the same thing in like 80 different ways. And I just started going nuts. It was stressful.
Does such a thing exist to embed it on your website yet or not?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I'm sure there's a way to, there's some site, do you want to say?
No.
If you know more?
No. So, I just want to ask my question.
Yeah, go for it.
No.
I know, she keeps asking questions. Just shut up.
I have a question, and I actually have a comment, which from that guy there.
A bolder question.
So the comment is that you know, self improvement is really big, and I think what you were saying was, how do you sell self improvement without also selling self doubt? Is that
good point?
Kind of.
I'm not sure, but sure.
Oh, okay. My question is, if you're willing to share, is what's your conversion rate on your pay gate? Because it's brilliant.
Oh. No one's ever called our pay gate brilliant before, so I take
it's
that.
Brilliant.
Well, the idea was kind of brilliant. Our execution of it is really bad.
Okay.
If you go through the steps, people have called it the Bermuda Triangle and stuff like that. It's really clumsy. So if you actually sign up, is anyone here subscribe to Elephant? Editor.
No.
Really? All right. Everyone else, yeah, just you can raise your hand if you say right now.
I have emails.
Uh-huh, cool. So the paying membership, you have to really want it. I mean, it's not that hard, but our messaging is pretty bad because we've never A-B tested any of it. But what was the question?
What's your conversion rate? The number of visitors, you know, the percentage of visitors that convert, because it sounds like you're doing a good job.
Yeah, I wish Dave Rogers were here. He's our, Yeah. No, I mean, I can answer you with the number. But what he would say, he would laugh in a kind of mournful way, like with no joy. And he would say, we do a horrible job. Part of his role is to streamline the process and make it actually enjoyable and have good messaging that's kind of mindful or something you connect with your heart instead of this sort of clumsy messaging. Like I just went on there and I swear to God, like the final message you read when you sign up was written by my accountant, I'm pretty sure. And it's like a whole paragraph. There's no other messaging on the page, like when you check out. Whole paragraph about how you won't get a refund.
Of your wallet.
Yeah, and
it's worse than that. It's worse than that. Because, you know, 2 years ago when we were talking, I says, God, $12, I'm just going to do this just for the experience, right?
Right.
Well,
$12 per year. Yeah.
Yeah, 12.
I just can't figure it out, so I tell my secretary to do it, right? Before I know it, the year is over, and it canceled me. Instead of renewing me automatically or whatever, I had to go back and have that experience of saying, God, once you got my credit card, don't ever let go of it, you know? And, you know, I paid for a year, and that was it. I didn't, so anyway, I had to go through that experience.
I don't blame you.
So conversion rate.
Our strength.
And I feel like something I do consistently, and it's the reason we've been successful, or part of it, is that we're grassroots and we're independent and we're, people believe that we're human beings and they generally don't think we're actually out to make money in a kind of, you know, I don't know what the word is, but that's not our motivation. We want to make money so we can pay people. I pay my staff really well, but we're actually mission driven. People feel that, and that's why you bothered to try. Probably, maybe. That's why most people bother to try. But the downside is we're so historically so broke and so incompetent. We're doing well now, and that's why we have this chief revenue officer guy who's, you know, I paid $4,000 in the last 2 months just for this one segment. He makes a lot more than that, but just to focus on the pay gate. Mm-hmm. And his answer after 2 months is, we don't even have data. We don't even have a way to measure analytics because it was custom built in the beginning, so we're transferring it over, but we need a .NET person to sync it up with WordPress. You know, it's really hard. The temptation of selling out, I think, for most entrepreneurs is it's really hard to create a ecosystem or a universe that works completely. You know that with City Club or anything.
The fear of thinking that you're selling out prevents you from being a good capitalist. That's what we need. You know, there's nothing wrong with capitalism other than that one comment you made about Windex. It's like, don't ever do that.
Right.
Well,
nothing. Duct tape and Windex is what America is made out of. So when you go around and make comments like that.
So, you know.
No, I mean, I know you're trying to wrap up. I would just say on that point, so our conversion rate, despite all of that, is pretty damn good. It's maybe. I could email you with a number.
That'd be great.
I actually was about to say a number, and I'm pretty sure it's wrong. So, you know, but it is that long tail thing, and when you have 25 million readers a month or 14 million or whatever it is, that's going to be a lot of people.
Well, exactly, at $1 a month, too.
And part of the thing with Sina is you can sign up for 12 months or you can sign up indefinitely, and it's way cheaper if you sign up indefinitely. So I don't know how he got unsigned up after a couple months, but...
Email address.
If I can just wrap up with one sentence. So the point of this talk in my mind was, kind of speaking to your question, was how can we help this world in a way that the world actually wants to hear it and enjoy it and share it, that's genuine. And if you do that and your basic business is at all coherent, you can make a really good living doing so. So hopefully that addressed it. So thank you so much to the City Club.